a four-masted trading ship riding the element for which it was built. These splendid ships are a subject which often occupies the spare time of Norman Gryspeerdt. The time and patience spent in building a replica of such majestic vessels possibly epitomizes the attributes which Norman applies to his work in Bromoil. Norman Gryspeerdt's career in photography has been a long and interesting one, but it is his association with the Bromoil process which has brought him foremost acclaim. His Bromoil prints have graced the panels and walls of salons and exhibitions worldwide. His association with Bromoil goes back many years, but the Bromoil process evolved very much earlier. But let Norman Gryspeerdt explain.
Well, the Bromoil process came into being in 1907, when a gentleman called a well-born Piper wrote an article in the British Journal which illustrated how to do an oil print, what was essentially an oil print, with bromide paper. And of course, that of course was a great advantage because you could make enlargements. With the oil process, you can't. But it started a lot earlier than that. In fact, it started in 1839, when a gentleman called Mungo Ponton, who was a Scot, read a paper to the Society of Arts in Edinburgh, in which he outlined a cheap and inexpensive method of producing an image without the use of silver. But the snag was that his image was brilliant yellow and white, and that obviously didn't catch on very well. But it did start a train of thought. In the chemical that he used was potassium dichromate. And it wasn't long before a gentleman called Alphonse Poitevin came up with a gum process. The essential of the gum process was, of course, that the potassium dichromate hardened the shadows, the areas of the negative we let most light through, but didn't touch the highlights. And so that came about, and I have here a gum bichromate print by Harold Edwards, who is a member of the Eastbourne Photographic Society, and up to recently he was producing these lovely little pictures. Contact process, of course. So that was next process that came along. And then we had a gentleman called Joseph Swan, who came up with the carbon process. Now, this print here is by Alexander Keeley, who was a very famous photographer at his time, and arguably one of the finest pictorial photographers that ever existed, possibly with Leonard Mizon. Leonard Mizon worked entirely in the oil process. He did do a few bromoils, but mostly in the oil process. The next process that came along, of course, was carbro, which was a derivation of the carbon process. And this is a three-colour carbro, which I didn't do the print, I must admit, but I did originally do the transparency for this, and it shows the death of Romeo and Juliet in San Zeno Cathedral when I was working in the film industry, which was some years ago now. So we now come on to some of the advantages of the Bromoil process. First of all, it's pretty permanent, almost as permanent as the base itself. And this is a Bromoil which I did many years ago. I learned to do Bromoil in 1927 or 26, I think. And this was the first print I ever had in the Royal, much to my delight at the time, I remember. And it was taken in Freiburg in Germany. This was then also one which I used to do an awful lot of walking when I was a bit younger. Now I'm not so agile. But this one was taken was on the road between Barnstable and Biddeford one summer's evening. When you look at that, you can see what I mean about the low lighting, which is so essential for pictorial photography. And we now come on to what I would refer to as straight bromoils. Not exactly straight, because no bromoil is exactly straight, But very little extra work on a print like this. This was taken in Tuscany. You can see a little bit of handwork on here. All the highlights have been picked out on here on the backs of the sheeps. And there was a huge great rock here somewhere, but I can't see it now because I've obviously fiddled it in somehow or other. But now we're getting on to something which is a bit more interesting, because I went up one day, one of the few pictures that I've ever taken locally. I usually go abroad to my trips to places where I hope that I'm going to get the kind of photo that I like. And I refer to places like Tuscany, northern Spain, the Abruzzi Mountains, where you get these lovely old villages and old cottages and things. Because the type of Bromoil that I do is really suitable for this kind of work. I know there are workers in the Bromoil process who do beautiful, delicate little things, but I like to have something a little bit more solid. Nothing against the beautiful, delicate things. They are lovely, some of them. But somehow or other, I've always been attracted to the more robust type of Bromoil. And, of course, I always work in 2016, which most Bromoil workers, up till certainly Gordon Trodd's time, I'd never seen a Bromoil 2016 at all. This was a shot which I took up on Ashdown Forest. I went up to Ashdown Forest one day with a friend of mine. When we got up there, it was thick fog. And so that was the shot that I took. And when I got back home, I thought, what the devil am I going to do with this, you see? Now, one of the things about Bromoil, of course, is that you can do it in any colour. Monochromatic, of course, that is. Or as you can do colour Bromoils, three-colour Bromoils, but they are hideously difficult to do, I should think. I've never tried one. You can only do them on the transfer process. But this one was taken on Ashdown Forest, and you can see the difference between the one which I've got here, which is the original one, and this. Because, as you can see here, I've changed the colour, made it a blue print, and put the sky in. Now, this is a red chalk one done of my daughter. She is now, 50, I don't know. Better not tell you, she's about 52, I think. But you can see, that's in red chalk. This one, again, was taken in Bulgaria. I was mooching around one of the monasteries, and I came outside and I found these people sitting playing cards outside. The hills, of course, have been put in. The hill wasn't there at all. That's put in with a piece of newspaper torn to shape and then just inked in. Bromoil, of course, the kind of Bromoil I like, is very great advantage for this kind of portraiture. An old and rugged lady used to walk up and down just outside here, and I grabbed her one day and I said, would you care to come in and have a portrait taken? She looked a bit old-fashioned. And that was the result which I got, which I was very pleased with. Luckily, my time in the film industry has taken me several countries all over the world. And when I worked on a film called Zulu out in South Africa, and this lady here struck me as a rather attractive face. I don't think she liked the look of me very much, but that didn't worry me. And I took that, but you can see here there's a considerable amount of control in the foreground here. This is the final print, where you can see for yourself all the foreground has been darkened down to concentrate the interest on the face. An ideal subject for a Bromoil, of course, lovely. That's the original, and that's the other. I took that to a camera club once, and I was rudely asked, was it by any chance a picture of my mother-in-law? But it's not so. Again, in Venice this was, delightful place. I went there three times taking photographs. It's my old friend Cal Humphreys, who we've been on one or two trips together. And here you can see that the highlight's been brought out on his hat, and this shadow here wasn't there. You'll see the shadow goes straight out here. But that was again put in with a piece of paper cut to shape, and then just inked in. The Abruzzi Mountains are a delightful area. We found, I went to a little village there, and I said to the local barkeeper, which is font of all information, of course, where is there an old village round about here which is of interest, you see? So he said, well, if you don't mind going up so-and-so, you'll come to a magnificent old castle. But he said, you'll find nobody there because it's completely ruined. And this is the shot I did of that. They were doing a bit of repair work. They've got an arc lamp up there, as you can see. But you don't see it in the final. And all this was picked out to show the highlights. And again, the old magic hills in the background, which were put in with a piece of newspaper. And a bit of a cloud thumped in after. All this lot picked out to give you the effect of the light, which was that one there. And altogether, it made quite an attractive shot. I have an idea. It was in the salon. Yes, it was. That's right. Now, this is one taken in Barcelona. There's an area of Barcelona which was originally part of the old fairground. Well, it was a fair in about 1910, I think. And I particularly like that, but the light was a bit flat. So what I decided to do was to highlight her and lose her, make her go into the shadow, and cast a highlight across there and darken all that. And this is the final result, which shows you the slight difference in as much as this, of course, was just hold a piece of paper across this area here and just put the ink in there, ink her in, and bring the highlight out on the steps with a pencil rubber, which rather, well, I think it improves it. I don't know if you do, but I had great fun doing that. High Pyrenees, again. Obviously, if you look at this first print, you'll see that the rock in the foreground is what attracted to me, and the background. Didn't like this. Picked out the highlights on that, and so again, you see you've got all the highlights here showing on the rocks. Here we've got some clouds and things in the background, and again a bit of a semblance of a hill in the distance. My God, it was cold up there. Bergamo, a delightful spot up on the top of the hills. Now this figure was actually there, believe it or not. I didn't put that one in, but all this I felt needed lightening up to give it an effect, and all this needed darkening, which is quite simple, of course. And this is the final result, which, again, I'm not thinking I've shown that anywhere yet. Nope. And this was all picked out with my old magic rubber, again, to sort of give the highlights. A little bit of highlight on her hair, which tend to change it again. Ah, Ronciglione, just north of Rome. Lovely old village, beautiful village. Here again, I wanted to darken that, you see, darken that here, pick them out there, and remove that, which is very unsightly, drain pipe coming down the side of the house. So that came out, and that's the final result of that one. But you can just see here where the drain pipe was removed. And there again, you see, what was happened was I took the whole wall right out, made it quite white underneath, and then proceeded to darken it in with a very fine brush. So you've lost that horrible sort of piece of white, wasn't even catchlight, going up the side.